Texas now. I hear the voice of my great-granddaughter saying, shut this pipeline down.
This summer, we had the honor of partnering with the Youth Climate Interveners. Throughout, we gained knowledge on climate change and pipelines broadly, but Line 3 specifically. We also learned the overall effects of Pipeline 3 environmentally, socially, and culturally.
My name's Andy Pearson, and I'm the Midwest Tar Sands Coordinator at Minnesota 350. The 350 comes from the upper limit of carbon pollution in our atmosphere, and we know that we need to stay at or below that number if we want to have a stable climate.
My name is John Abraham. I'm a professor at the University of St. Thomas, where I teach engineering, and in particular, I work on both climate change and also renewable energy projects around the world. So climate change is the long-term change of the weather patterns on our planet. Well, humans are the major player in climate change. Right now, the added heat because of human emissions is equal to about 5 Hiroshima atomic bombs every second.
There's a lot of ways that climate change would affect the Earth in the future. One of the biggest ways is by creating heat waves and heat patterns in the summer months.
We're seeing sea level levels rise. We're seeing more intense storms. We had a tremendously expensive hurricane season last year. We had a drought in California that was the worst drought in over 1,000 years. And these things are just tastes of what's going to come in the future.
One of the biggest impacts is that some places are simply going to become uninhabitable.
Around the world, 150 million people live within 3 feet of sea level rise. So 150 million people are going to be displaced.
The reason that I think a lot of folks concerned about climate change are also really concerned about oil pipelines is because these pipelines enable this industry that pollutes our climate to keep going on.
Line 3 and similar pipes carry the worst of all possible pollution. So when you have structures like Line 3 built, what that means is we're going to mine more of this stuff. And we're going to make the future climate even worse than it already would be.
We want to try to do better. And one of the first things that has to mean is stop building the problem that you're trying to fight back against.
The Line 3 pipeline was proposed in 2014 by a company called Enbridge Energy. Enbridge Energy is the largest pipeline company in North America, and they are responsible for some of the largest inland oil spills in history. My name is Akila Sanders-Reed. I'm 24, and I'm one of the 13 youth climate interveners in the fight to stop the Line 3 pipeline. They proposed this pipeline as what they call a replacement for an aging pipeline of theirs that's in the ground now, also called Line 3.
It's twice as big. It carries twice as much oil. It's going to bring twice as much carbon emissions into the atmosphere. My name is Molly Soash. I volunteer with Minnesota 350 and our pipeline resistance team.
Tar sands oil specifically, it's the same stuff you've heard about with the Keystone XL pipeline.
That oil comes from up in Canada. It's in northern Alberta. It's an area about the size of Florida, all told. And unlike oil that you might think about seeing in the news, you know, oil derricks are kind of where people might drill and then you get a geyser of oil. This oil doesn't want to come out of the ground that easily. This oil kind of has to be mined.
This gooey, thick, tar-like substance that has to get diluted to be sent through a pipeline. The Line 3 pipeline would transport over 760,000 barrels of tar sands and to go through an almost entirely new route through northern Minnesota that cuts through some of the best wild rice beds in the world and near the headwaters of the Mississippi and through some of our northern Minnesota lake country. If there was a rupture on this pipeline, it would be devastating no matter where it happened.
The Enbridge permitting process for Line 3 was a trial that lasted about a year, and anybody could file to intervene, but only a few got selected to actually be interveners. I'm from the Santee Dakota in Ho-Chunk Nations.
My role in the Line 3 case was an expert witness for the Youth Climate Interveners. And what that meant was I was past tobacco and asked to speak on a few various areas that I was well versed in. Hi, my name is Sheila Lamb. I'm a community advocate, and I also have a group working with trafficked Native youth. So we testified, we proceeded to give our evidence, and then the judge made her recommendation.
So working alongside all of them, we made our case to the judge, who in April of this last year said that Enbridge's proposal, as they had written it, would be illegal to approve because of the consequences it would have to society as a whole. That social cost of carbon would be over $287 billion in just the first 30 years this pipeline would operate. What we saw from the Public Utilities Commission just this past June of 2018 was them approving Enbridge's preferred route and approving the expansion of Line 3 exactly as Enbridge had proposed it. They were too cowardly to stand up and make the decision that a judge, the majority of the intervening parties, 94% of the public comments on this issue, the Minnesota Department of Commerce, the Department of Natural Resources, the Pollution Control Agency had all asked them to make, which was to deny the permits for this pipeline.
During the hearings, they talked about jobs, and everyone wants to focus on jobs, but we heard 0 to 5 long-term jobs are all that are going to come out of this pipeline, whereas our unions could have greatly benefited by taking out the old decaying pipeline that they failed to maintain properly. Commissioner Lipschultz with the PUC used this phrase. He said, we're sitting here with a gun to our head. So when you have the chairwoman crying as she is placing her vote, and you have another commissioner making comments like that, what it came down to is Enbridge allowed this line to deteriorate so badly. Not only are they required by the federal government now to fix it or replace it, but they put the state of Minnesota in a position of being very fearful that if they continue to use this line, we would have another catastrophic spill. The final decision right now and what it means for the indigenous community is that we have a lot more work before us. We have the appeals process, we have all the legal proceedings. It's truly not a done deal yet.
The decision on Pipeline 3 doesn't only affect the Earth's future, but it also affects the communities who fight against it, the biggest being the indigenous communities surrounding Pipeline 3.
We do see where pipelines are prevalent on reservations and increase in health issues and cancers. We've seen an increase in suicide rates, depression, domestic violence, drugs, and a lot of it is associated with multi-generational historical trauma.
When they build pipelines, they also build man camps, and so that's where these pipeline people live when they're building this pipeline. And when these men get bored, they have a tendency of going into reservations and stealing young Native girls and raping and killing them.
Children as young as 4 and 5 have been found in these camps, and males as well. If someone is going to participate in these behaviors, a little seminar is not going to stop them on any level.
The Native community also lacks voice when it comes to issues such as land rights.
We're considered wards of the government, as if we're inept children that are not capable of taking care of ourselves or making appropriate decisions for things. Treaty rights give us the ability to hunt and gather, to take care of our religious freedom, which we did not have that right again until the mid-60s. We're supposed to be sovereign, but those things don't come into play the way they're supposed to because of the multiple violations against our treaties. When you're affecting things like our wild rice lakes, and wild rice to us is a sacred food, when we don't have the freedom to be who we are as an indigenous people, to use our language, to hunt, to gather, to conduct ceremonies, and to know that those things are safe, then add the cultural impacts, the impacts to our wild rice, to our medicines, and the treaty violations, I don't see how anyone in good conscience can ever agree with this pipeline.
Fighting against a system that's designed to refute their efforts and determination, these individuals are true definition of activists.
So I got involved in activism around climate change when I was 15 because I realized that my future was going to look drastically different than any other years ever lived by people on Earth, unless we did something immediately. Watching the wildfires that are sweeping across the western United States breaks my heart. I had nightmares about forest fires as a kid. Climate change is a matter of life and death.
All it takes for us to reach climate catastrophe is doing nothing. It takes a lot of responsibility and a lot of courage to come out and say this is not the way we want our future to be.
Standing up to the Line 3 pipeline is important because it's an assault on our climate, it's an assault on indigenous rights, and it's an assault on our generation.
we need to be writing our legislatures, or if there's petitions to sign. I know a lot of those come around, but those are important. Even maybe an extra step is coming out to meetings and seeing, educating yourself on the issue, or seeing actions that happen and coming out and really putting your body out on the line.
Martin Luther King Jr. once said, "If you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward."
Well, one of the great things about the climate change problem is we can solve it. We can solve it with today's technology. And if we're smart about it, we can build the economy of the future. Wind, solar, biodiesel, other renewable energy. We can build the economy of the future, give people great jobs, and solve the problem of climate change. And that's what I'm excited about.
I see the beauty all around me in the state of Minnesota. I'm 20 minutes away from Lake Superior. It's culturally important to us. It's important to us from a water aspect. But look at the beauty that surrounds us and the things that we're known for in Minnesota. So when you take all of that together, I have no choice but to keep fighting.
Each individual is fighting for their beliefs and freedom. Each has determined as the next to keep fighting against the structure that will affect us. How will you fight to keep the oils in the ground? To get involved and help the movement, you can sign a petition at www.actionnetwork.org.
Shut this pipeline down. Yeah. People gonna rise like the water. Gonna face this crisis.